I want to return to Russell's theory of descriptions, so let's remind ourselves of what it is. And then we'll look at the puzzles that Russell lays out that he thinks establish his theory and show you that it's preferable to Frege's theory, show you essentially that it solves these puzzles that otherwise might be problematic. So let's begin with the general outline of Russell's theory. What does it mean to say VF is G, for example? The father of Charles II was executed. Just in informal terms, what does that mean for you?
There is an F.
Okay, good, there is an F. So yes, we're trying to understand VF is G, and we've got, okay, there is an F.
There is a G.
That's gonna follow. We don't have to state that independently, actually.
There's only one F?
There's only one F, yes. So we've got uniqueness here. There's only one F. And then we can say either every, or some, or that. F is G, because after all, there's only one, so all of those end up being equivalent, right? So to say the father of Charles II was executed is to say there is a father of Charles II, there's only one father of Charles II, and every Charles II's father was executed, okay? Or some father of Charles II was executed, or that father was executed. Okay, so that's the general idea. We analyze definite descriptions as basically asserting the existence and uniqueness of the thing fulfilling the description. Notice something interesting about this. Russell talks about something, everything, nothing. The last time we saw how his logic handles those, but it handles them in terms of a quantifier, like for all x or for some x, that just applies to anything in the universe. You cannot do that with the. We could not have a quantifier that said Vx is such that, right? Because that would say, well, there is an x and there's only one x. But what do you mean there's only one x? We need to know what f is. F and g play different roles here, okay? So this subject term, this sort of unit, Vf, has to be understood as a unit. You cannot separate the from the f. And I think that's part of the reason that Russell says, look, I can't tell you the meaning of Vf in isolation. I have to tell you the meaning of that in the context of a sentence. It will contribute to the sentence meaning in a certain way, but I can't isolate it all by itself. Why? Well, in part because we have to know sort of how it's functioning here, but partly also because we cannot separate the from the F. Vf is something saying there's one and only one F, and then something about that. Okay. So, for example, some F is G and some G are F. Those just mean the same thing, right? I shouldn't say they mean the same thing, but they're logically equivalent. However, the F is G and the G is F do not mean the same thing. The father of Charles II was executed, and the guy who was executed is the father of Charles II. Those are not equivalent statements. Why not? The father of Charles II was executed, and the guy who was executed was the father of Charles II. What's the difference? Yeah?
There'd be something like where one is where he's like the direct reference or something like, I don't remember the specific word.
Well,
first.
Yeah, we haven't said what to do with Charles II, and so there is a sort of problem there. In fact, Russell's view is going to be that all these proper names are really definite descriptions, and so Charles II is going to have to be, well, now what? What could be the description going along with Charles II?
Do you just mean somebody can be executed and not be
the father? Yeah, exactly. Right, whatever we do with Charles II, the fact is that the father of Charles II was executed implies the existence and uniqueness of the father of Charles II. But the guy who was executed was the father of Charles II. That implies the existence and uniqueness of the guy executed. But what if other people were executed? Actually, back in those days, lots of people were executed. Most of them were not the father of Charles II. And so that second sentence implies the uniqueness of somebody being executed in a way that the first one doesn't. So we can't switch these around. The F is G is not equivalent to the G is F. Now, Russell says, okay, why do I have this theory? Well, he says, any good philosopher should stock their mind with puzzles. Now, why? Well, because not only is this good general scientific practice, it is good philosophical practice. You need to have a theory that's going to solve some puzzles. And indeed, a way of doing bad philosophy is to say, here's so-and-so's view, here's why I don't like it, here's my view. And people actually often do this without coming back around and telling you how they solve the problems they lay out and they explain for somebody else's view. Well, don't do that, okay? Russell's paper is a kind of model of philosophy, partly because he lays out these problems for Meinung's view, for Frege's view, and he shows why they're problematic, but then he shows you how his theory solves them. And so he ends up saying, look, it's really important to think about puzzles like this, to confront views with them, and to make sure the view you craft actually solves them. He says a logical theory may be tested by its capacity for dealing with puzzles. And it's a wholesome plan, thinking about logic, to stock the mind with as many puzzles as possible, since these serve much the same purpose as is served by experiments in physical science. I'll therefore state three puzzles which a theory as to denoting ought to be able to solve. I'll show later that my theory solves them. Okay, so here's the first. It's really a sort of Leibniz law puzzle. If A is identical with B, whatever is true of the one is true of the other. And either may be substituted for the other in any proposition without altering the truth or falsehood of that proposition. So, we've got some puzzles, and here's puzzle one. And I've just said sort of a Leibniz law. Now, what do I mean by that? Well, Leibniz said things are identical when they have exactly the same properties. And one of the things that's going to follow from that is that if A equals B, then anything I say about A should be true of B as well. Okay? So suppose 2 plus 2 is 4, and I say 4 plus 1 is 5. Then 2 plus 2 plus 1 is 5, right? I can substitute 2 plus 2 for 4, or 4 for 2 plus 2, and preserve truth. And so this is sometimes referred to as a matter of, well, this is only sort of one half of Leibniz's law. Substitutability, as Leibniz himself put it, salva veritate. Preserving truth. And so here in logical terms is what this amounts to. If I have A equals B, and let's say F of A, that should imply F of B. I should be able to substitute one term for the other. Okay, and actually that should go in both directions. If I've got F of B, I should be able to get F of A, because it's a symmetric relation. But now, fine, so yes, that should in general work. But what happens when, you might think of Frege's problem, what happens when we put this inside an attitude context? And so, just as with the morning star and the evening star, we hear say, now George IV wished to know whether Scott was the author of Waverley. And in fact, Scott was the author of Waverley, hence we may substitute Scott for the author of Waverley, and thereby prove that George IV wished to know whether Scott was Scott. Yet an interest in the law of identity can hardly be attributed to the first gentleman of Europe. Nobody thinks that's funny.
Yeah, I didn't get that. I thought that it was supposed to be funny, but...
Look, philosophy doesn't have many jokes in it. And here's one of the philosophical jokes, right? So you have to learn to appreciate this sort of philosophical humor, because it doesn't come around very often. But yes, okay, what's he saying? Here's the idea. George IV wished to know whether Scott was the author of Waverley. Dummy. Okay. Well, Scott is the author of Waverley. But now, apply this rule, right? We can substitute identicals for one another, and so we should get George IV wished to know whether Scott equals Scott. But that's silly, right? I mean, you can imagine a king who is interested in the law of identity, And he says, well, is it really true that for any A equals A? Maybe not. I remember having a conversation like this at the lunch table one day in college. A particularly ornery fellow saying, I don't see why I should think that's true. Why think that A is A? You might expect that I'm going to go on to say he became a continental philosopher. But no, it's not true. He became an anesthesiologist. So now he spends time knocking people out, and I suppose wondering whether they're still self-identical once he's knocked them out. Now, if you think about this, you can say, well, all right, here's we've got, presumably, let's say, a true premise that George IV wished to know whether Scott was the author of Waverley. He reads the novel, and initially the novel came out and anonymously, and wonders who wrote this, and conjectures Sir Walter Scott. Okay, but he wants to know whether Scott really wrote this. Well, it is true that Scott wrote it, so in the end, it is true that Scott is the author of Waverley, and yet George IV wished to know whether Scott was Scott. No, that's false. Okay, so we've got what looks like it should be, right, a valid argument form, turning out to fail here. We've got true premises and yet a false conclusion. So what's gone wrong? Well, what can we say? Notice what Frege would say about this. Frege is going to say there's a difference between meaning and denotation, right? Between sense and denotation. Wished is one of those verbs that creates that takes a subordinate clause, basically. Or maybe you could say it's really know or wish to know as a unit. You could blame the wishing or the knowing or the combination of those. But in any case, what follows then is something that is in indirect discourse. And in those cases, what is referred to, he says, is actually the sense, not the ordinary denotation. And so we can only make the substitution if the sense of Scott is the same as the sense of the author of Waverley. But it's obviously not the same. So Frege's analysis would be, look, these verbs, wished to know, okay, that's screwing things up. That forces us to think what's going on inside is in this indirect quotation context. It is something that we have to understand as referring to its own sense. And so the substitution can't work. This says they have the same denotation, but it doesn't say they have the same sense. In fact, they obviously don't have the same sense, or nobody would wonder whether one was the same as the other. Well, Russell says that's not the best way of thinking about it. We've already seen that there's a problem in trying to deal with that, because we now have to have something weird going on. The referent of Scott here is no longer Scott. The referent of Scott is the sense of Scott. And that's strange and seems unmotivated and so on, and might lead us into some infinite hierarchy of senses, or maybe not. Maybe Kripke's right that we can avoid that. But whatever we want to say about that, we realize that that becomes a complicated story if we really try to work it out. Russell says there's a much simpler way of doing it. What is going wrong? Well, George IV wished to know whether Scott was the author of Waverley. Now, for the moment, I'm going to ignore Scott and just pretend that's a directly referential name. Really, in the final analysis, Russell thinks that's an abbreviated description too. But let's pretend it's not, just to simplify the situation. We've got this description, the author of Waverley. So we have to think, well, wait, that's not a simple term. That's not like a B here. What is the logical form of something like Scott is the author of Waverley? Well, we have to analyze it in these terms, right? The author of Waverley is Scott, is roughly what that means. Or the author of Waverley is such that Scott is him. And so what would that mean? Well, this is going to mean, gosh, someone wrote Waverley. Only one person. Wrote Waverley. And Scott is that person. But now once you write that out, you realize, I don't have any simple term for substitution here. This isn't a case of substitution. It's something else. Incidentally, there's also an ambiguity in this first premise. Why is that ambiguous? Well, look, it could could be that George IV wished to know whether there was one and only one author of Waverly, and that person was Scott. Or it could be that there is one and only one person who wrote Waverly, and George IV wished to know whether Scott was that person. In other words, if I say George IV wished to know whether Scott was the author of Waverly, am I committing myself to the existence and uniqueness of the author of Waverly, or am I saying that George IV was committed to it? I can put, in logical terms, that quantifier that goes along with the author of Waverly inside the scope of wish to know, and so George IV wished to know whether, now, whether there is one person who wrote Waverly, and only one person who wrote Waverly, and that person was Scott, or I can say, yeah, look, there's an author of Waverly, right? There's one person and only one person who wrote Waverly. And George IV was wondering whether Scott was that person. And those are different things because they involve different commitments from mine. Now here, one and only one person did write Waverly, and so it's, you might think, unproblematic. But suppose we had something in here that does not refer. What's an example of a description that doesn't refer to anything? The present king of France is Russell's example, right? But you can craft many others. So suppose we say, George IV wished to know whether Scott was the present king of France. Now, who thinks there's a present king of France? Is it the person who speaks that sentence, or is it George IV? It could be either way, right? It could be that the author of that sentence is saying, look, there is one and only one king of France, and George IV wanted to know whether Scott was that king. Or it could mean that George IV wanted to know whether there was one and only one king of France and Scott was that person. And in this case, you know, assuming we're saying it, it would be like George IV, you know, by, actually, it wouldn't make any sense for George IV, but if it were George III, we could say, yeah, look, he's kind of crazy and he thinks that the present king of France and, you know, he, but humor him, he wants to know whether the present king of France is Sir Walter Scott. And it would really be in his mind. So there's a scope ambiguity here. Is the author of Waverly something that occurs within the scope of the wish to know, or is it something that goes outside? That's going to matter in some cases. Here it doesn't, in a sense, because we already have a recognition that this doesn't have anything like that form, and so the substitution isn't really a factor. Yeah.
What exactly does scope mean?
Scope, okay, yeah. As I was saying this, I was thinking, there's something really important I haven't explained, and I better do it. So, let's think about what really is going on here. This could mean either that George IV wished to know whether, and now, right, someone wrote Waverly, only one person did, and that person was Scott. Or it could mean someone wrote Waverly, only one person did, and George IV wished to know whether that person was Scott. So if we were writing it out in a certain way, we might think that we could represent this as in these terms, and so this is really a question of whether it's sort of like George IV wished to know, I'll just put it that way, and then whether the F is G, or it could be the F is such that George IV wished to know whether it is G. Yeah.
So the argument in this case is in the form like G is the F, right? Because Scott is the author.
Right.
It can't be the other way, right? Because the word the clues us in that like the author has to be
Yeah, here the it is G is really something like equals scum. And so here, whether, really it's sort of like, we need a variable that's gonna tie these together. And so that's gonna have to be tied in there in some way.
What I mean is,
yeah.
Can you like construe the Scott was the author of Waverly in that like there's only one Scott, there's, you know.
Oh yeah, yeah, okay, good. Yes, if we actually start thinking, wait a minute, Scott too in the end for Russell is a definite description. Something like the man named Scott. Then we realize, oh, wait a minute. Then it's actually more complicated because we've got this saying there is exactly one person who is named Scott, and there is exactly one person who wrote Waverly, and they're the same person. And then you're right, there is actually a scope ambiguity. We've got there's exactly one and there's exactly one, and they could go in either order. Luckily, in that case, I believe, they, yeah, because of the identity, they turn out to be equivalent. So there, it doesn't matter which order we put them in. But still, in terms of the logical form, if you think of these as two descriptions, as you would with the evening star and the morning star, then you end up saying, well, gosh, am I saying of the evening star that it's identical with the morning star, or am I saying of the morning star that it's identical with the evening star? And there is a little bit of a, that's a scope difference. In the end, it will work out that it doesn't make any difference in those cases because we just have a simple identity instead of something complicated. Yeah?
I mean, but could you say that George IV wished to know whether there was someone named Scott, there was only one person named Scott,
oh,
and that Scott will see out there later?
Okay, yes, good. As soon as we say, wait a minute, Scott is also a definite description, then you're right. We've got the same issue arising for that. And so it could be that both of them should go inside the scope of George IV wish to know that, or wish to know whether. It could be that one comes outside, or the other comes outside, or both come outside. So in that case, we would actually get a fourfold view. Is he wishing to know whether there's one and only one person named Scott, and one and only one person named Waverly? Or are we committing ourselves to one and only one Scott, one and only one Waverly, Bopper, etc.? So you're right, it would be a fourfold thing. You might think, ooh, we're getting a lot of meanings here.
I mean,
senses are proliferating all over the place.
The author of Waverly, though, in this has to be a definite description.
Right.
Because of
right.
B.
Yes.
If it was Scott was happy or something like that, then it would be the other way around. That it was really the definite description in that case would be Scott.
Well, oh, yeah. In this article, I think Russell doesn't really commit himself with respect to what's going on with proper names. By 1918, proper names are just other descriptions. And so then even Scott is happy is going to be, there is one and only one man named Scott and he's happy. If that's the way, I mean, the man named Scott, that's just my little substitute, simple description. He sort of wonders what the actual description is, and you might with Frege worry, wait, there could be lots of descriptions that pick out Scott. I might say he's the author of Ivanhoe, and somebody else might say he's the author of Waverly, and somebody else might say he's this and that and the other. So it becomes complicated. And I think here, he's treating the name as if it's just a name, and so not worrying about its descriptive character, too. So it'll simplify things if we do that as well, and just treat Scott as something like an A or a B.
So the sentence, Scott is happy, doesn't apply to this, since Scott is just a true name.
Right, right. For our purposes here, we can just assume that's just like S is happy. But in the final theory, some 13 years later, that's really a description too. Yeah.
So basically the sentence, Scott was the author of Waverly, is equivalent, and this example, to the Scott was the author of Waverly?
In that final theory, yes. The Scott is the author of Waverly.
Okay.
And so there is one and only one person who fulfills the description associated with the name Scott, and there's one and only one person who is the author of Waverly, and those two are identical. And that's messy, actually. In the first edition of deduction, I wanted to include definite descriptions, and so I introduced a little description quantifier to stand for the. And you could write sentences that look like this. The F is G emerged as like tau of X FX of GX. Okay? And I gave people a variety of problems without thinking about it too hard, really, or working all of them out. I worked some of them out. But I ended up coming up with problems. Well, I won't go in. They look simple on the page. But somebody once wrote to me a few years after the book came out and said, I'm having a lot of trouble with a certain problem on page such and such. And I looked it up, and it was like, well, but it had a couple of these definite descriptions, okay, together with, I think, most and some other things that complicated the picture. So I started doing the problem out. And to prove what I had to prove a biconditional. So that means you have to prove an if-then in this direction, and then an if-then in that the other direction. It took me 145 lines to prove the first half. And so I wrote back and I said, well, you can do the problem. Here's half of it. By the end, it will be roughly 300 lines long, this little proof. And I wondered why that book wasn't more of a commercial success. But yeah, this becomes complicated fast. And you can already see that once you think, wait, this means something like Buscott is the author of Waverly, just to write that out is kind of a pain, right? That's complicated. And now start doing that with something like, oh, I think one of my examples was something like this. Any more experienced college administrator can speak less meaningfully than any less experienced one. So the most experienced college administrator speaks less meaningfully than any other. That turns out to be both extremely complicated to write out and also just to be really hard to prove. So anyway, there are things like that that quickly become messy once you get a bunch of these descriptions read, because they all introduce ambiguities, and they all, many of which don't matter in the end, but they also give you these scope issues and require you to basically say there's one of these, there's only one of these, and blah, 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 and so it gets really messy really fast.
So anyway, one of the two scopes did Russell think was the case?
Oh, well, here it doesn't actually matter, simply because he says, look, this is ambiguous, but we don't need to even worry about that, because this is not an identity statement. It doesn't have the form A equals B. Okay? So, as he's going through this, he ends up saying, look, here is my solution. By the way, there is, in his discussion here, separating the problems from his solution, there is this long excursion about Gray's elegy. Skip it. Okay, there is a big scholarly literature on whether any of that makes any sense. Many people think in the end it's all a confusion. He's screwing up the quotation marks. There's no way to make sense of it. There is a long paper arguing, no, if you're really careful, it does make sense. It's one of those philosophical traps that basically you can lose years of your life worrying about it. So my advice is, don't worry about it. It doesn't really go anywhere here. Anyhow. But here's what he says when we get to the fourth problem. Okay, so he says, let's see. He has this great example. I've heard of a touchy owner of a yacht to whom a guest on first seeing it remarked, I thought your yacht was larger than it is. And the owner replied, no, my yacht is not larger than it is. That's another philosophical joke. You have to refine your taste, and start laughing at these. Anyway, well, he points out, what the guest meant was the size I thought your yacht was is greater than the size your yacht is. The meaning attributed to him was, I thought the size of your yacht was greater than the size of your yacht. That's a scope ambiguity, basically. To return to George IV and Waverly, when we say George IV wished to know whether Scott was the author of Waverly, we normally mean George IV wished to know whether one and only one man wrote Waverly and Scott was that man. In other words, we mean this sort of thing, right? George IV wished to know whether this stuff. So he says, that's how I really am interpreting this. But he says, we may also mean one and only one man wrote Waverly and George IV wished to know whether Scott was that man. And that is this meme, okay? That corresponds with VF taking wide scope, as we say, and George IV wished to know whether taking narrow scope. Here, the George IV wished to know whether takes wide scope, and the narrow scope is the scope of VF that occurs within it. In any event, he calls this a secondary occurrence of a denoting phrase. In the latter, the author of Waverly has a primary occurrence. So here it's primary. That means wide scope in modern parlance. And here it's secondary. That means narrow scope. Well, how does all this help us? Okay, yes. Well, he goes on and on about this, but let's not worry about that. He never comes back to the question. The ambiguity between first primary and secondary occurrences is hard to avoid in language, but it does no harm if we're on our guard against it. But yes, in a sense, we've got already that problem. But look at what happens here. Scott is the author of Waverly. Ends up meaning someone wrote Waverly, only one person wrote Waverly, and Scott is that person. And so that is something that doesn't leave us any way to substitute, right? There is no constituent, as he puts it, that corresponds to the author of Waverly that's left anywhere. And so there's no way to do a substitution involving it because it's gone. It dissolved into other things. Well, all that was puzzle one. Now we turn to puzzle two. But relax, it's a little easier. By the law of the excluded middle, either A is B or A is not B. Must be true. Hence, either the present king of France is bald or the present king of France is not bald. Must be true. Yet if we enumerated the things that are bald and then the things that are not bald, we should not find the present king of France in either list. Hegelians, who love a synthesis, will probably conclude that he wears a wig.
That one was funny.
That's a good one. Now, okay, so is the present king of France bald? Let's look at that. The present king of France is bald. How do we analyze that? Well, here we don't have an attitude verb like wished or knows or anything of that sort, so that's good. How would we analyze this in Russell's terms? The present king of France is bald. What does it mean? We just go to this and we say, aha, okay. There is a present king of France. There's only one. And that present king of France is bald. True or false? False, right? There is no present king of France. So it's false. Now, it is true that if we're looking at the list of the bald and the list of the not bald, we're going to go down and list them, and we won't find the present king of France there. And so is that a problem? Now, actually, in Frege, it is a problem, okay? Because Frege thinks we need a denotation, and we don't have a denotation. So at one point, Frege is saying, that means this is truth fabulous. I say the present king of France is bald, and you say, well, there's no present king of France. In other words, you say, I don't know whether to call that true or false. I look for a present king of France, I don't find one, there's a gap there. And so there is a truth value gap corresponding to that. It is neither true nor false. At one point, however, Frege says, look, that's kind of inconvenient. I mean, it sort of screws up our logic. It doesn't really screw it up. You can have a three-valued logic or a partial semantics where you allow for these truth value gaps. But suppose you don't want to do that, and Frege didn't want to do that. He said, let's let terms like this denote something like the null set so that we give it a denotation, and then we can say this really is equivalent to the null set is bald. And then, okay, we can false it. The null set is not bald. And Carnap later does something similar. He says, look, these terms that don't denote anything, let's just introduce something for them to denote. Okay, some dummy object. Yeah?
How would this handle something where, like, instead of the present king of France, it was a name, like, if you said Louis XIV was, or if you say Louis XIV is bald, not was, but is.
Right.
That work out? If it's like a proper name and not a description, but it still doesn't exist.
Well, yeah, that gets into the problem of what we do about times. But okay, suppose we do take that. Louis XIV is bald. Before we think about logic or Russell or Frege or anything else, just tell me, is that sentence true or false?
Well, he's probably bald in his grave.
Yes.
Ooh, right. Yeah, I mean, one person, sort of person might say, well, gosh, I have to go back and look at the historical records. He's often depicted as wearing a wig. Must be a Hegelian before his time. And you could think, okay, so what does he look like without that wig? That would be one way to look at it. Another would be to say, well, is, you mean present tense, so let's dig him up and find out. Probably he is, though, you know, gross. Somebody else might say, but look, he doesn't exist anymore. He did exist. Tense, in combination with these questions of existence, becomes kind of tricky. Does Socrates exist? If I say Socrates is a philosopher, should you object to say Socrates doesn't exist anymore, so at best your claim is truth valueless? I don't know. And so I don't really myself have any position. There are philosophers who think that only the things that exist in the present exist. Only the present is fully real. Those people are called presentists. Others say, no, the whole past is real. Maybe the future isn't real yet, but maybe the things that will be real. And so we have to understand these things across time. I think it's actually awkward at some level to adopt any particular strategy. So I have no view about which works out best. Yeah.
Would representations like portraits get over that problem?
Well, how would a portrait help?
Well, I mean, if we were to see a portrait of Louis the 14th, or Louis the 14th, and then would we be able to say that he's bald looking at the portrait?
That would give us evidence, certainly. You could say, well, of course he still exists, but now he's just an image in a portrait. that seems to me really weird, though. It's like he died and became an image in a painting. I don't know what happens to people when they die, but I'm pretty sure they don't just become images in paintings, so that's an odd way of talking. But yeah, I mean, in the end, we could take different attitudes about this. There is something weird about combining somebody who used to exist but doesn't anymore with the present tense is.
But
and I don't know what to do about that, really. Yeah.
Right, the sense of him still exists.
The sense of the name.
Sense of the name.
Yeah, sure, that exists. But the denotation, you might argue, doesn't any longer exist. So what do we do with the present tense? That sort of thing becomes problematic. And yet if I say, wow, you know, I was teaching the analytic tradition this morning, and Louis the 14th walked into the room. That's clearly false, right? And so I think it's...
Unless his name is Louis and he's born on the 14th.
Well, it could be a different... Yeah. Actually, an interesting thing. Many people are called Scott, right? Names do not tend to pick out... Well, some names are unique. There are only like 13 Bonnevacs in the world. And so Daniel Bonnevac actually picks out... Well, I shouldn't say that. I thought it picked out me uniquely, but actually, I'd have to give my full name for that. So it's not actually entirely unique, even in that case. But suppose your name is John Smith. I have friends from, you know, old days I've wanted to look up in the days of Facebook and stuff, but they have really common names. And so how do you do it? You know, you look for somebody of that name, and you find hundreds of examples of people with that name. And so I don't know how to find the right one. And so that's in general a problem here. There's another problem with the thesis that names too are descriptions, which is that you keep trying to find a description that goes along with the name. It's pretty safe to say the man known as Louis XIV or something like that. But as soon as you try to substitute another one, like Aristotle, you know, the teacher of Alexander the Great, well, now we've got another name, Alexander the Great. How do you cash that out in terms of a description? And where do these ever end? Yeah.
Could we say that, like, instead of my name is John, so to speak, you could say, like, my denotation is John? I mean, is it...
Well, no, you don't have a denotation.
Isn't...
I mean, I'm a person. I don't have a sense and a denotation. My name does, okay, according to Franke. So Daniel Bonnevac, that has a sense and has a denotation, he thinks. But on the other hand, I don't, right? This piece of chalk doesn't have a denotation. And so yeah, I mean, it's not that I... It's like, ooh, what's your sense? that doesn't make any sense.
Okay.
It's only sort of linguistic expressions that are going to have senses and denotations. Or maybe thoughts that correspond to them. Yeah?
How would you treat, like, fictitious... persons who, like, we understand to exist, so, like, Othello, like, how would he, like, Othello exists in that's a
strange
creation, but, like,
was
never actually a person?
Good! Great question. There are all sorts of examples. I mean, the present king of France is easy, right? Because there's no particular fiction behind that. It's just something that doesn't denote anything. But if I say, yeah, give me names of people who don't denote, we can write it where the name doesn't denote. We can say, well, look, gosh, there are all sorts of sources of this. For example, fiction, like Othello, or Sherlock Holmes, or, you know, blah, 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 blah. You can list fictional characters. And now, do we end up saying everything you say about those is false? You know, Othello, yes, so as we're in English class, and I assigned you Othello as a reading. Somebody comes in and says, man, I hated this play. Why? Every sentence in it was false. None of these terms denote anything. It's awful. I did a Russellian analysis, right? And, you know, there's one, there's one and only one woman named Desdemona. False. And so yeah, fiction is a problem. What do you do about that? Yeah.
I mean, the term fiction carries within it that it ultimately not corresponds to our reality, so I don't see why it would be a problem if the facts within the story is false to reality, because the category is intended to be fictitious. So.
Ah, okay, good. Some people have a theory of fiction that says, really, there's this big once upon a time operator that goes before any work of fiction. And really, that's a way of saying, suspend all this belief, right? Just don't worry about the truth values of what's going on here. We're now talking about some other world, so don't think about this world, and don't evaluate the claims in terms of this world. And that has some advantages, because then you can say, well, what is the denotation of something like Othello or Sherlock Holmes? It's something in some other world. Don't worry about it. It doesn't have to have a denotation in our world, because that's not what we're talking about. We're talking about the world of the fiction. There's going to be a problem there, because that world is going to be highly indeterminate. There are all sorts of things that are just not going to be specified in that world. But okay, maybe we can allow for that. It's a little more complicated than that, however, because often we say things that mix fictional and non-fictional names. For example, Sherlock Holmes lived in London at 221B Baker Street. True or false? If I'm thinking about the Sherlock Holmes stories, that seems true, right? But if I say, okay, Sherlock Holmes lived in London, true. Among the inhabitants of London was Sherlock Holmes. That suddenly feels false.
Well, in the other world, it's true. I mean, yeah. There can be some overlap.
In the other world, it's true, right. And so there's a weird interplay between the form in which we express something and what world we think we're talking about. But you're right, I think as long as we're careful to say, well, look, among London's inhabitants was Sherlock Holmes in the world we're discussing, because all of this has to be understood as within that once upon a time operator. And that fictional world we're discussing will have overlap with the actual world, and there will be real things that appear there. Now, how much license can somebody have in work of fiction to describe things that actually do exist, but describe them falsely? I don't know the answer to that question, but it seems to me, in a sense, not a logical question. If somebody says, yeah, Sherlock Holmes lived in London, which was a small village in Africa, you're going to think, wait, what? You mean there's a small village in Africa named London? Oh, no, I'm saying the city of London was at this time a small village in Africa. It's hard to understand that fiction, right? It's something like, actually, we see the Futurama, where Richard Nixon is now just a head in a vat somewhere, okay? So there are kinds of fiction where there's something real, but something weird and false is being said about it, and ordinarily we can deal with that and even treat it as some kind of joke. So it's still intelligible, but there can be ways of pushing it that end up feeling very strange. Anyway, are there other sources besides fiction of names or descriptions that will not denote, and yet don't seem to be just the kind of thing where we say, ah, yes, it's false. Or truth values, for that matter.
Well, what about future tense?
All right, we get these the tense questions again. So, yes, anything involving the future. It doesn't exist now, but it will exist later. Right? I wrote out a will at some point saying, I leave to my children, blah, 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 blah. At the time, I had no children. That was a non-denoting term. Now I do, so now it denotes. But at the time I wrote out my will, I didn't have any children. But still, I talked about my children in the will. And so it was that sort of future tense problem. It would be very strange for somebody to read over my will back in 1983 or whenever I made it up and say, filled with non-denoting terms. Other sources of this.
Mythical creatures?
Yeah, mythology. Or, you know, and it might be myth in the sense of Greek myth, or just legends, or perhaps, I don't know, things like Santa Claus, or the Tooth Fairy, or other things like that that are sort of part of popular mythology.
It's still fiction.
Well, it's sort of a fiction, except there's no author, really, right? I mean...
Does this fiction require an author?
I don't know. I don't know. Paul Bunyan, Santa Claus, the Tooth Fairy, Zeus. There's not really an author there, and there's not really a canonical work of fiction, maybe, even. And yet, in a certain sense, there are things we can talk about. Yeah.
What about things that are fictional but that function as truth, let's say, so an example of Santa Claus. The parents might pretend Santa Claus is real. There are a lot of cases where kids know that it's not real, but they pretend Santa Claus is real in order to appease parents, so that you have a situation where when the kids and the parents talk about Santa Claus, it functions as a truth, even though both know it's false.
Yeah, okay, good.
Something that...
There's a general thing you might think we really need a theory of here, which is pretense. We need to know what it's like to pretend something. My daughters used to have these extended pretend games, and I really couldn't play with them. I sometimes tried, but it was impossible for me. They had all these, well, at one stage anyway, they had all these Beanie Babies. And they would set up elaborate plays with the Beanie Babies. And they could do this for hours, right? And it was all based on a sort of pretense of what was, you know. And I found, it's not that I can't pretend, but I had no idea how to pretend that, right? And I'm not sure why. Maybe it's just that I'm a guy, and when I pretended things as a little kid, they always involved killing people. we played war all the time. And so we were always sort of World War II guys out on a mission in the backwoods and, you know, trapping people in ambushes and throwing rocks at people and stuff like that. It was a wholesome environment. But yeah, that sort of thing was anyway, but there was pretense going on there. And it was sort of like within the game, certain things were appropriate moves and other things were not. There were well-defined moves in that pretense. And something similar is the case with Santa Claus. Imagine... It's not as if everything you can say about Santa Claus is on the same level, right? Somebody says, oh, Santa Claus wears a hat and wears a red suit and has a white beard. All that seems right and part of the pretense.
But
if somebody said, yeah, Kafka's version of this, Santa Claus is a large cockroach that crawls down the chimney. You know, that you're this perverted uncle comes in and starts telling him that.
Exactly.
I was like, no! And it's not just because Santa Claus doesn't exist, because there's something really wrong with that story.
Right. That's
yeah. But in this case, notice there's not really an author. It's just somehow, there's something rule-governed about what the later Wittgenstein will refer to as a language game here that's going on with that pretense. Yeah.
Isn't Santa Claus kind of a strange case because people dress up like Santa Claus, and when you see someone dressed up like Santa Claus, you would refer to them as Santa Claus. So Santa Claus would denote something real in the world, yet the sense of Santa Claus as someone that lives in the North Pole and flies would be false.
Right. Yes, in general, you might say there are roles like this, like Santa Claus. It's obvious in a case like Othello, you might say, you know, Laurence Olivier is Hamlet. And it's like, well, no, not really. Hamlet was a Danish prince, and Laurence Olivier was not a Danish prince. But nevertheless, he's playing that role, right? And so sometimes we mean it. The guy in the red suit is Santa, we say. And, well, he's playing that role. And so there is a sense of is there where playing the role is enough to qualify you, even if literally there's no person behind that role. Yeah.
But the case with Santa Claus seems especially odd because it's not talking about another world. It's like,
yeah,
specifically making a claim about our world. And I think you can do that some in fiction, too. Like, if you, like, say you have, you know, you look up to some character or something, you know, or you act like that character, or something like an interaction between yourself, which isn't necessarily in this world, and the world of fiction, right? There's some overlap.
Right. Yeah, exactly. A lot of these cases of pretense don't feel the same as fiction. You're right, for partly that reason. These are claims that are we're pretending are true of our world, not that we're saying, aha, there's another world that I'm describing now. It'd be one thing if you said to a child, once upon a time, you know, there was this being, Santa Claus and so on. But that's not what we do. We do something different. Yeah.
Also, names about which there's some debate whether they denote anything, like God or tachyons or something like that.
Ah, right. Sometimes there's a real issue about whether something is a denoting term, God or tachyons, or a variety of other terms in science that refer to theoretical entities. There are some people, scientific realists, who say those things are real. Other instrumentalists deny it. They think all that's a fiction. You could think the same thing about mathematics. Some people in the philosophy of mathematics are fictionalists, and they think mathematics is all an elaborate fiction. It's like, as it were, once upon a time, there was this infinite collection of numbers, and zero, you know, was the first one, and then we added one, and we got one, and we kept going. And in short, yeah, you could be a fictionalist about mathematics or about electrons or all sorts of things. We're out of time. Next time, we're going to look at Russell's collection of essays that make up the lectures on logical atomism. It's long. I will put out an announcement telling you which ones to read. You don't have to do all of them.